basically on the story of Noah. Most of you are familiar with the basic premise of Noah, and so we're not even going to take this first session to read everything, and I trust that in between sessions, if you feel the need to read, you can do that, but there's really nothing tricky in the story. It's all pretty much what you learned in Sunday school or children's church, except the Lord has some different things for us today. I kind of look at this conference as a continuation of last year's, and last year I wouldn't allow them to put what I shared on the web because I didn't think it was complete. I felt to have it on the web as it was not good enough. It needed to have some backup. I didn't share on Noah. It's just the principles that were shared there need to be followed up, and interestingly enough, I didn't plan it, but this is the perfect follow-up for last year's conference, so I'm thankful to the Lord for that. And this session right here is going to be more or less an introduction to what I'm going to be sharing during the conference. And you know, most of you know me real well, and you know that I would prefer actually not to share at all in conference or to share once. And the Lord just put it on my heart. And we've been sharing in the Bible school on Noah. I've been sharing now for some months on it. And just the Lord told me that there was going to be a section that he wanted me to share during the conference. And so I was teaching and teaching and teaching. And then all of a sudden it came up time to stop teaching in the Bible school and get ready for the conference. And we stopped right at the place where the Lord told me that he wanted me to share for the conference. So for the Bible school students, it's sort of just a continuation on of what we've been going over. And so one of the facts on this is that, you know, for some people, they cleave to the doctrine of Christ and him crucified, and they hold on to those truths, and those truths are everything, and that's good. But the truth is, you can hold to the doctrines and the teachings of Christ and him crucified and never have to face any of your own junk. Anybody know what I'm talking about? You start facing junk when your heart softens and you actually want to be conformed to the image of Christ. That's when the trouble starts. So I'm warning some of you now before you get in too deep. If you really just want to go the easy route, just get into all the doctrines and don't ask the Father to conform you to the image of his Son, because he'll do a different work in your life. Okay? But if you want Christ formed in you in a real way, in a practical way, then God the Father is going to faithfully lead you not just through green pastures, but through the valley of the shadow of death and a whole lot of other things. But the end result will be, what is the name of our CD? No longer I, but Christ. Amen? No longer I, but Christ. And that's our goal. But there are a lot of people who get confused in the journey from, let me put it this way, they get confused in the journey from me to him. Because there's junk that happens, and you can actually wonder if you're still on the journey or did you get off on a side road somewhere. And I believe an answer to that heart cry to know where you're at and to know that maybe you really are right in the middle of the will of God, even though it may not feel like it at times, and to know that the Father's hand is upon you and that he is bringing about that conformity, because that is what is in his heart for you, just as it is in your heart. And I felt like the Lord wanted me to share that, primarily coming out of Genesis here. So Genesis chapter 6, and first we'll read verses 5 through 7. And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And it repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him at his heart. And the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast, the creeping things and the fowls of the air, for it repenteth me that I have made them. Now, if you'll jump over to verse 17, and behold, I, even I, do bring a flood of waters upon the earth to destroy all flesh wherein is the breath of life from under heaven, and everything that is in the earth shall die. And then let's go to 19 and 20, and we'll finish reading those. And of every living thing of all flesh, two of every sort shalt thou bring into the ark to keep them alive with thee. They shall be male and female, of fowls after their kind, and of cattle after their kind, of creeping things on the earth, of the earth after its kind. Two of every sort shall come unto thee to keep them alive. All right, when a lot of times when discussing Noah's Ark, there's a lot of different things that people focus on. I mean, you focus on Noah, you focus on the Ark, you focus on all of the different things that involves, the trip, the new world or the new creation, however you want to look at that, the flood, all these different things. But in this conference, I would like to focus on, the term I'm going to use is this. I would like for us to focus on the beasts. The beasts that are in the ark with Noah. Okay? Some of you seem to be familiar with the beasts. Praise God. But honestly, before we can really get into that clearly, what I want to do is I just want to take the time, and I want to set the groundwork for what I'm going to be sharing here. I want to take the time to go through and to see some things scripturally from God's point of view, and to do that, we're going to have to take a few minutes to just go through quite a few little scriptures here. So if you would, turn with me to Leviticus chapter 11. There is so much here that we could read, actually, that I'm just going to pick a couple of verses here. Verse 20 and 21, all winged insects, this is what he's calling unclean, all winged, well, I tell you what, let's, because we'll run into this guy later on, verse 15, every raven after its kind, this is an unclean animal, given by the Lord. And verse 20, all winged insects going upon all four shall be an abomination to you. Then if you drop down to verse 29, these also shall be unclean unto you among the creeping things that creep upon the earth. Does that sound sort of slimy right there? Anyway, the creeping things that creep upon the earth, the weasel and the mouse, and the tortoise after its kind, the ferret, and it goes on and on and on. Verse 31, these are all unclean to you among those that creep. And I'm not making a reference to anybody in this room per se. Deuteronomy chapter 4. Well, I didn't say the Lord might not be. But Deuteronomy chapter 4. And this he's beginning to talk about idols and what they cannot look like. And in verse 17 and 18 of Deuteronomy 4, he describes them. Don't make any idols in the likeness of any beast that is on the earth, the likeness of any winged fowl that flieth in the air, the likeness of anything that creepeth on the ground, the likeness of any fish that is in the waters beneath the earth. Okay, now if you'll go to Ezekiel, and as I said, we're just going to hit several scriptures here to get this out of the way. Ezekiel chapter 8, and this is before the glory, I think it's just before the glory, yeah, before the glory departs from the temple. There were things going on in the temple of God. Anybody understand who the temple of God is in the New Testament? There were things that were at work and being, but they were sort of hidden out of the way. In Ezekiel chapter 8, God speaks to Ezekiel and wants him to come look at something particular here. And Let's start at verse 6. It's the Lord speaking to Ezekiel. And he said furthermore unto me, Son of man, seest thou what they do, even the great abominations that the house of Israel committeth here, that I should go far off from my sanctuary? But turn yet again, and thou shalt see greater abominations. And he brought me to the door of the court, and when I looked, behold, a hole in the wall. Then he said unto me, Son of man, dig now in the wall. And when I had digged in the wall, behold, a door. And verse 9, and he said unto me, Go in, and behold the wicked abominations that they do here. So I went in and saw, and behold, every form of creeping things and abominable beasts, and all the idols of the house of Israel portrayed upon the wall round about. And so you begin to see from different angles this understanding of fowls of the air. Anybody familiar with creeping things, these beasts that he's talking about? Now let's go, just to confirm this, let's go into the New Testament in Romans chapter 1. And we'll just read verse 22 and 23. I guess we can read 21 through 23. Because when they knew not God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man and birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things. Okay, now let's go to, and I had, believe it or not, I had way more scriptures that I'm going to give here, but I thought these would be sufficient. 2 Peter, if this doesn't get you. Cassie said some of you may not be feeling it yet. 2 Peter chapter 2. Yeah, it's creeping up on you, isn't it? Okay, 2 Peter 2 and verse 11. Whereas angels who are greater in power and might bring not railing accusation against them before the Lord, but these as natural brute beasts made to be taken and destroyed, speak evil of the things that they understand not, and shall utterly perish in their own corruption. And notice particularly, but these as natural brute beasts. And God is using, or Peter is using this allusion to those who are out of tune with the Lord. Though they're, quote, people of God, they're out of tune and they're acting in the manner of natural brute beasts. Okay, and now book of Revelation, chapter 13. Revelation 13, verse 4. And they worshiped the dragon who gave power unto the beast. They worshiped the beast, saying, Who is like unto the beast? Who is able to make war with him? And let's skip down to verse 7. And it was given unto him to make war with the saints and to overcome them. This is talking about the beast. And to overcome them, and power was given over all kindreds and tongues and nations. And now verse 11. And I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb, but he spoke like a dragon. And then finally, Revelation 18, and this will be our last scripture, and no one else has to jump up and leave. Revelation 18, verse 1 and 2. And after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was made bright with his glory, and he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and has become the habitation of demons, and the hold of every foul spirit, and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird. All right, it just got worse as we went. You know, I mean, you know, the further we got into the New Testament, it just brought to bear that there is this thing, this reality, that Noah was told to bring all these things into the ark. And we know that there was a judgment upon the earth, but he was told to bring, you know, all this in there. But what is it now? What is it that came into the ark? Well, there were, and you know, I didn't even read Matthew 13, which, if you're familiar with the parable of the sower, he said, sowed seed beside the wayside, and the fowls of the air came and took it, and they said, what is your explanation of this, Jesus? And Jesus said, this is demon spirits coming and taking the word out of your heart. Okay? And so God is saying to Noah, you know, I want you to take all these things, and remember, here they are over here in the old creation, as it were, and God's going to destroy that and bring them into the new creation. He's going to do that through this bridge, which is the ark. But he takes creatures from the old creation, and he puts them in this confined place with Noah. Okay? And there's this whole reality of what it is that's in there and what it is that he's having to deal with on a daily basis and what it is that, you know, has been brought about here. Because these beasts, they never looked into the eyes of the Lord and found grace. Remember it says of Noah, Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. These beasts never looked into the eyes of the Lord and found grace. They didn't know God in a special way. They didn't have a special relationship in that sense. They were a representation of all the other beasts that were destroyed. They were a representation of everything that was being destroyed in the old creation, but it was put into that ark with Noah and with his family. And so now, of course, all the other beasts that are just like them in nature and whatever, they're all being destroyed outside in the flood, right? They're all being dealt with, but that's those people's beasts. That's the people's beasts who are in the old creation. You understand what I'm saying? That's their things, and their things died instantly. You understand? But Noah, bless his heart, he wanted the Lord. And so God's going to have to deal with him in a little bit different way. And he's going to have to begin to move in a certain way that causes Noah to begin to, I'm going to say it like this, face his own beasts. Now, some of you have wondered what the heck is going on. When I was a Christian and never heard of this Christ and Him crucified thing, I was a good person. And it seems like the more I know Jesus, the worse I get. And the example I always give of that is if Jesus is sitting on a throne of glory and he's just glowing over there and I'm way back over here in the corner, I'm not too affected by that. But the closer I get to him, the worse I look. Isn't that true? I mean, because his glory is going to show up everything that's wrong with you, you know? And you're going to see, you're not only going to see him, you're going to see a contrast of you and him. And it's these kind of things that say, oh, Lord, I must decrease. He must increase and I must decrease. These are the things. It's an actual fact of getting closer. It doesn't feel like you're getting closer. It feels like you're getting worse. And stuff's showing up, and you're going, what's wrong with me and everything? I think I'll go back to the faith message or something, you know? You know, then everything was perfect, and everything was beautiful. But the dealing is different, and your heart is different, and the Father is treating you as his own son, meaning he'll correct you and he'll bring you into certain realities. And so you know, and we know, I mean, there's a spiritual implication to all this. In the natural, obviously, Noah was simply saving and preserving animals so that they could survive the flood. Okay, that's in the natural. That's all he was doing, saving and preserving animals so they could survive the flood. And maybe that's as far as we ever got in our mind. But the spiritual implication is this. that Noah's going to have to face his stuff too. He's going to have to look at it, and he's going to have to deal with it by the Lord, and he's going to have to deal with it personally by means of the cross. And all that cross for him is going to be represented by this ark experience. Because let me just point out a couple of things. One is over here, this altar is over here in the new creation. They're heading to the new creation. Amen? Where all things are new. Behold, all things are new. It's going to be a brand new creation. That's where he's heading. And he's been taught that you're already raised up. But I'm just going to plant a little seed here, and that is, you're raised up in the ark, but that is that's you being raised up. But in the new creation, he is the resurrection. There's a difference. There's a big difference between the two. One is, you know you're raised up in him. Inside the ark, resurrection was taking place. As everything was being destroyed, resurrection was happening. Amen? But that was not Christ as the resurrection. That was still an understanding of Jesus' resurrection and you in him. Does it make sense? And does anybody see that maybe if you focus too much on just being raised up in him and not him becoming the resurrection, that maybe you're going to be stuck in an ark for a long time? That Christ, that the ark is just a vehicle to somewhere. The new creation. Right? Amen. So let's look over in, Matthew 24. Matthew 24 and verse 36. And let's read to 39. But of that day and hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. But as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered into the ark, and knew not until the flood came and took them all away, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Is it possible to begin to come to a revelation of Christ, and it begins to separate you from the world, from religion, from so many things, this revelation of Christ, but it has not yet fully separated you from you. Now let me make it clear, and we'll get into this more as we go. Of course you're dead. You're crucified with Christ. Of course you are. I'm not refuting that. But I am saying that if there's anybody's experience that they have begun to see Jesus, and they know they have by the Holy Spirit, and God has begun to reveal his Son in them, and yet they keep seeing beasts popping up, then maybe this message is for you. Maybe God has some answers and wants to help and wants to show that maybe you're not as bad off as you thought you were. Maybe you're not really in some sort of a bad place, but you're right, flowing right along with what he's got planned for you, that his Son might be all and in all. And that's his purpose. So from these scriptures and from the account of Noah, we see that God is dealing in judgment, isn't he? He's dealing in judgment. There's no question about it. The flood judges those who are outside. It judges those, who do not enter into the ark. And let me say this, the ark does represent being in Christ, but it is not the full representation of being in Christ. It is being in Christ, but the full representation of being in Christ is the new creation. That's That's where that ark's trying to get you. Are you in Christ in the ark? Yes. But you have not yet fully arrived, even though you left. How about that? Anybody left yet? But you have not fully arrived yet, maybe, for some of you. So, flood judges everything that's outside, but there's one thing. The people who are outside, they don't have to face up to their own individual problems. They're eating and drinking and everything's going on normal, and then boom. Do you understand what I just said? They're not at that time faced with anything that they've got wrong or any beast or anything like that. They just have one big general judgment. Flood gone, over with. God bless them, man. That's right. But in the ark, they're going to have to face their own individual beasts. They're the ones that God's pointing out to them, the one that God brought to them and said, okay, now we're going to have to discuss this kind of stuff right here. And let me tell you what, this dealing and this judgment and this death, and if you've got the chart, I've got several different words for it. I mean, the first line, they go across from left to right. The cross and the old nature, the cross and the self-life, the cross as the new nature. And I'll just allude to that a little bit right now. Over here, the judgment is the flood judgment is a judgment, or is the cross upon the old nature. All of the old nature died instantly in that moment. Okay? But in the ark, it's another aspect of the cross, where God is dealing with the self-life. He's dealing with stuff that you still having problems with certain things, and you don't understand because you're saying, well, everything's dead. Can I get an amen? Or at least an oh me. You know? And then finally, and I'm not going to speak a whole lot on this, but the first thing Noah did when he got out was he built an altar. What is an altar doing in the new creation? I thought everything's dead and gone and there ain't no more altar. This altar in the new creation is, as I put it here, the first one says the cross and the old nature. That's over here in the flood. The ark is the cross and the self-life. This one here is the cross as the new nature, the Lamb of God. Okay, because guess who's on the throne for eternity? The big bullied king? No. A lamb, a small lamb, as though it had been slain. Okay, so if you've studied a lot about this cross, this judgment on the old nature, you know it's a finished work. It is a finished work. And we will base everything on the finished work, but I got news for you. God isn't going to just wipe it out in one instant in you. He's going to deal with you, and he's going to bring you to, as it were, each of these beasts and have you settle it. And let me throw out a thought to you. Have you ever looked at the scriptures where it says something like, okay, like the old man is dead and everything, and then it says, if you walk in the spirit, you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Well, does anybody think, that's like a sort of a contradiction or something? I mean, if it's dead at the cross, I don't need to walk in the Spirit. It's dead. And, you know, I mean, let's be real. Let's not just paint pretty pictures and walk ignorantly. I mean, let's find the truth of the heart of God here. Why would he say, if the cross settled it, why would he say you got to walk in the Spirit so you don't fulfill the lust of the flesh? That's part of what we want to deal with during this session, these times. So we want to begin to see that there is a work that God's doing in us, not just a historical work 2,000 years ago when he did a big work and now we all just go, okay, praise God, glory, you know, as we walk around bumping heads with one another, you know, and go, well, okay. Just, you know, I mean, the example I usually use is we go, oh, magic woofle dust. Everything is all right. It's not all right. We're a mess. Amen. The people who believe this stuff are a mess. And need to continually grow up in him in all things. In other words, There's more of Jesus to know. There's more of a reality of his life to be worked into us. And so these are the things that we want to get into. And this cross of the ark, that cross is for those who want to conform to his image and who want the new creation to become a reality in this life. Thank God I got a few amens there, because some might go, well, no, that can't happen in this life. I mean, the new creation, the new creation is not a place. It's a reality that we're supposed to be already in. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. But what's the rest of that? Old things are passed away. Folks, in the ark, old things are not passed away. Old things are all around you. Can you see that? I mean, can you see Noah looking around going, well, if it's passed away, what the heck are they doing here? You know? And I'm telling you, I see stuff in me from time to time that I just go, what is that? I've been believing this for 40 years. I've been preaching and everything. Where did you come from? You know? And you go, again, the problem happens when you really want Jesus. I mean, when it's not just, okay, I just want to believe this great message, but when you say, God, I will not be satisfied with these reactions, with this stuff, all this stuff that goes on, I renounce that. And you can renounce it all day long. You know, can you imagine Noah in the ark? I renounce you, creeping thing. I renounce you, fowls of the air. Face the north of the ark. Some of you know what I'm talking about. And those things are not going to disappear by renouncing them. And they're not going to disappear by the flood. They're not. They're in that ark until you step out into the new creation, and then they disappear. So that means that there is a work of the cross, and there is a work of the Spirit in relationship to the cross in your personal life. Praise God. Amen. All right. So in this chart, and let's face it, this is a shadow. This story in Genesis is a shadow. No shadow is going to be a perfect picture. It gives you a vague picture of the true. And so here we have a picture, and of course, I don't know if you can tell, this is the water up here, and these are fish around here. That's why that's supposed to look like the flood there. But I marked it on in your chart that this flood represents death. This ark represents burial, and this altar or this new creation represents resurrection. Okay? Death, burial, and resurrection. Some people just believe in death and resurrection. That's why the flesh stinks so much. Uncle Bill, here's the way we say it. Oh, he died over here, but he's with the Lord now. And somebody's saying, could you bury him? He's been here for 6 months. I believe in death and resurrection. Well, I believe in burial. Could we get the dead flesh out of sight, and out of mind? Boy, how many of you like that old man out of mind too? Hallelujah. And then I just put down the flood representing Romans 6, which deals primarily with the death of the old man. Romans 7, here's a guy who already believes Romans 6. I believe that. But oh, wretched man, And so he's going through all this stuff. And then Romans 8, well, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Do you see how nifty that worked out for my little chart? And then I put old creation, the bridge being the ark, the old creation being the flood, the bridge being the ark, and then the new creation, and then down at the bottom, Egypt, the wilderness, and the promised land. The flood being Egypt, the wilderness being what? They've been delivered out of, but they have not yet come into. I mean, they're making the journey, but they have not entered into. And most of their focus is on what they left or what died, not what lives, which is Christ. You know. And so what do you see in the wilderness over and over and over? You see them confronted with their own issues. You see? And so, and then the last one, I just put the curse, the broken law, which is God said, you know, if cursed is anyone if you break my commandments, you know, if you break it in one point, you've broken the whole law. But the other curse is, cursed is him that hangeth on a tree. This is when you go to the cross with him. Amen. And a whole new form of curse starts dealing with. And then in Genesis, God, once Noah and his family step out of that ark and everything, and he builds that altar, God says there will be no more curse. You remember? And so you begin to see this progression going on here. All of these factors represent Christ, all three of these stages, the flood, the ark, and the new creation. They represent Christ in a different form. As believers, we must keep our hearts open to what? To Jesus. We must continually hunger after him and not make camps around one area of truth or another area of truth in that sense, you know. Because if we do, we'll never go on. I always say that good is the enemy of, or better is the enemy of good. If we're doing good, we don't want to do better. If we're doing better, we don't want to do the best. You know, we just don't want to do bad. That's, you know, that's our main doctrine. I just don't want to do bad. If I'm doing good, I'm all right, and then I settle in and I don't keep seeking because I'm doing good. See? No, better, more of Jesus, more of Jesus, more of his reality. And so there is this reality of the death of the old man. There is this reality of, I mean, folks, there is a doctrine in the Bible clear cut that the death of the old nature is a finished work, done. But Jesus said, also take up your cross daily. Amen. Is that not in there? Yes. Yeah, sure is. And do you not see the fruit of that in Paul and in other of the writers who are having to still deal with stuff, but they're at least dealing with it by the cross? Hallelujah. But it's another aspect of the cross. It's another aspect of Christ. And then the new creation settles a whole bunch of stuff too. A whole bunch of stuff that was a problem. Even though you were saved, even though you were out of judgment, even though, you know, it wasn't until you stepped out into that new creation that a whole nother set of freedom began to come and reality began to come to you. So they all represent Christ in a different dimension. And I've got three up here. You know, let's face it. There's so much more of Jesus. I don't know everything, you know. I mean, all I can tell you is I'm knowing Jesus. All I can tell you is I want to know Jesus. But I'm not, you know, like John the Baptist said, I'm not him. You know, I'm not him. I'm pointing people to him the best I can. But I'm not him. But I want him. And I want to know him. Why? I don't want to know him so I'm smart or deep or impressive. I want to know him so that he truly lives in me and through me, and that I can be content to say, Christ, not I, Christ liveth in me. And that truly, truly, truly be some, not just a doctrine. Because, you know, you can say that. It's not I, Christ liveth in me, and it's so you. You know, you can say that. You know, you can quote those words. It's not I, but Christ, you know. And your wife says, it's you. You know what I'm talking about. And so, I didn't really put it up here, but this would be like an arrow and a progression. And for our study today, we have three in relationship to that. But there's so much more of Jesus to know. And let's never stop. And let's, you know, a lot of times we tend to have everything fixed in our mind, what we know. And our security is not in Jesus. It's in the order and the grasp of the truths that we have. Does anybody know what I'm talking about there? And we answer according to those things instead of according to the Lord. And it may be Jesus that is our answer because, you know, we wouldn't want to give anything else but Jesus. But number one, it's not Jesus by life. It's just what we figured out. And when that question's asked, this is the answer we give. And it can become cold after a while. And I'm sorry, but I believe it's possible to continue to maintain a passion after Jesus and to say, I have not yet attained. Paul said that. I have not yet attained, but I press towards the mark. You know, there are men and women and people that know so much more than I do. It's just ridiculous. I mean, I'm not trying to catch up to anybody. You know, I'm going after Jesus. And I figure that if just a little bit, if I just share a little bit and that little bit is Jesus, then that's worth it all, you know. And so, and that Jesus that I share be life. And these things the Lord has so stirred on my heart so much that night after night prior to this conference, I have laid for hours praying for us. Because I want the Holy Spirit to break through and to bring a new, fresh. Don't you think that new creation was so fresh? It was incredible. I mean, it's like, whoa, you know. Where's the smell of this? Where's the smell of that? Where's the, you know, it's just all fresh and clean. Oh, come on. Don't you want that? Don't you want the Lord in a whole fresh way? Don't you want the winds of the Spirit just to blow through you? Can you imagine the stench in that ark? Can you imagine? I can see Noah sitting over on a barrel going, you know, and somebody come, one of the kids come up and says, you know, it stinks in here. He goes, I know the Lord. I'm not one of those that died out there. I wasn't left behind. I've got faith. I found grace in the eyes of the Lord. I know I'm lifted. I'm raised up. I'm above this. And the guy says to him, man, it stinks in here. We don't want to give pat answers. If we don't know, we want to say, I don't know. But I want to know. You know, pray with me and maybe we'll know together. You know, and let's make it a journey together instead of a hierarchy of this person is here and there and there and there, you know. And, you know, it's like Tony when he first came, you know. He said, well, I was a little nervous, you know, meeting you and coming here to this place and everything. And I said, you know what? You don't have to worry about that. We're all just people after Jesus, just like you are. And we're all just sort of herding together, going after the Lord, wanting the Lord, desiring the Lord, seeking and praying. And I said, you won't have to worry about any of that feel of whatever. I think pretty quickly you'll realize, you know, if you'll help hold me up, I'll help you hold you up. You know, and that's just the heart that I want us to have. And I want us always to hold on to the Lord in that way and then hold on to one another in that way also. All right, so Romans 7 or this situation of the ark is like a cocoon. This may be new to you. Any of you familiar with the butterfly? Kelly's whole thing on the butterfly. You know, it's this whole reality of a caterpillar, which represented by the coming out of the old, and then the cocoon, represented by a place where you face your death. Folks, the cocoon is not some little party in there, one-man party, you know, a little Mexican hat and maracas, yeah, you know. Man, you are wrapped up, you are limited, and yet you're on your way to the new creation. You're about to bust out, but you don't feel like it. Can I get an amen on that? You don't feel like it. You, everything within you can say, I'm headed in the wrong direction. You know, maybe, you know, God said build an ocean liner. And I heard ark. Because, you know, it just take a couple of weeks in there to realize this is not going to be fun. This is not going to be a joyride. This is not an ocean liner. This is not Carnival Cruise Lines. That's what some of you are finding out now. This is not Carnival Cruise Lines. Amen. You're going, and here's your problem. You shouldn't have loved Jesus the way you do. You shouldn't have wanted to go after it because you did. Now, instead of just being wiped out, you know, and see, we say, well, those poor people in the flood, they lost their homes and they lost their, you know, farms and they lost this and that. And Noah did too. His house was gone. His farm was gone. Everything he knew and was familiar with was gone. The difference is it wasn't just wiped out in that sense. It was taken out of his life and he was being taken to a place where all things would become new. You know, there's no need fighting to preserve our house or our this or that or whatever. There's no need, you know, I mean, that's going on all over the nation right now. People trying to preserve something that, what if God said, hey, I'm going to just give you something new. I can't believe for that. Everything's bad. You know? Yeah, it is. Everything except in the new creation. You step out there, it's all yours. You say, oh, brother, but that's just spiritual talk. What, you know, how would God take care of my... Are you serious? You know, I've often said, I remember one time in our church, we were facing some real crises financially and otherwise. We were going to go down the tube in a very short time. And some of the elders at that time, it wasn't the men that we have right now, but they came to me and they said, oh, Randy, we didn't realize that we're looking at the books. That'll, you know, I said, you need to look at the book, but nonetheless... And they said, oh, man, it's bad. I mean, everything's going down the tubes. We're going to, you know, if God doesn't do a miracle, we're, you know, I mean, and they were freaked out and upset. And if God doesn't do a miracle, man, I don't know what's going to happen. And after they finished, I just leaned over and I said, don't we believe in a God of miracles? We're in church. Oh, God can do a miracle. God, you know, I mean, you know. And they kind of went, oh, yeah. You know, it's like that was a doctrine. But we've got a real issue here now. I'm thinking, this is what we believe. This is the perfect opportunity for the God that we believe in to come through. You know, I said, let's get our eyes on him. Let's trust him. He's incredible. We can believe for him. And it wasn't just a bunch of hype. It is this reality that God is leading us. We're not on our own. We're not trying to make our own way. We're not trying to figure it out. I've often said that, you know, most deeper life people, they're trying to become omniscient. They want to know everything and have it all figured out. And they think that's the goal, for me to become omniscient like God. No, he's omniscient. You don't know everything. You know him. He knows everything. This is all about a relationship with him, not about, you know, us. You know, it's like we're a little bitty, you know, and then we become, oh, yeah, I'm super Randy. You know? That's scary. That's why That's why the cross has to be first. You know? I mean, that is scary. Super anything of us is wrong. And so, and that's why this ark exists, because God has to prove that to us. And it's not proven to us yet, to some of us. We don't know how much we need Jesus. We still think we only kind of need Jesus. And so the road he's taking us down is not to beat us down or hurt us or destroy us or anything. He is funneling us to a place that we will believe in him with all of our heart, soul, and strength, and mind, and that our beings will be after him, and it will be more based on a relationship with Christ in a real way instead of with the knowledge of Christ. You know, it's almost like, you know, some people go to the Lord, and it's like he's on the throne, and they walk up there, and they walk up beside him, and they open a little door in the side of his head, and they just snuggle up to the knowledge of Christ that's in his head, you know. Oh, you're everything. No, Jesus is everything. And you may not know anything, and you can still get with him. Amen. Folks, the one before you ever heard of the revelation of Christ or the cross, he was faithful to you. He loved you. He was working in your life. Well, he still is. He hasn't changed. You know, some of you here know this story, but most of you may not. You know, one day we're driving down the road, you know, and I'm driving. My wife is over there, and she turns to me, and she goes, "Huh, you know, I used to sit over there by you, you know, sit over there in the middle by you all the time." And I said, "Well, I haven't changed." You know, you're the one who's eventually slipped way over there. I don't know, what was it, a curve or something? You know, never came back. You know, but that's the way it is with the Lord. I mean, we end up over there and we don't even realize that we've gone after the knowledge of the Lord. We've gone after this and that. We didn't go after Jesus. I mean, this whole thing about being a bride is about him. We're the bride of Christ. He's the groom. We want you, Jesus, not your billfold, you know. You know, I remember I was dating this girl. I'm sorry I'm getting off here. I remember I was dating this girl, and she said, I said, "You know, you really look nice tonight." And she said, "You don't like me for my brains?" And I just grabbed her head, and I went, "Oh, I just love his brains, you know. I love brains." That has absolutely nothing to do with Jesus. Sorry about that. All right, let's get back on track here. So the ark is like this cocoon where we are going, in a sense, to face our death. A death that took place already, but we're going to have to face it in a very real way. Because if we're going to walk with God in the new creation, we can't make pets of all these things. We're going to stay in that ark until God deals with us about us. And that's sort of a hard deal for some people, you know. They have a hard time with that. So, again, just meditate on this, and we're starting to get close to the end here, that the ark, though it represents the truth of in Christ, it does not represent the complete truth of in Christ. And consider that the ark is a means of getting you to your destination. It is not the end. Okay, there's two things that you can consider on that. One is there's hope. If you're in that ark, that's not God's intended end. He's got a big old wide place that he wants to bring you into. And it's his heart. He's the one who came up with the idea. We didn't. So it's in his heart. And the other one is just your own personal struggles and things and worries, you know, because we tend to think that certain people are so deep and spiritual that they don't have any problems. Oh, we believe that. Don't give me that. I was in Arkansas in June, and J.W. asked me to preach, and of course, as usual, I'm the last one to preach. He says, so-and-so has the word for this conference. I said, I'm the last one to speak. How do you know I didn't have? Love messing with him. Anyway, I'm up there talking, and my sharing was all on this reality of what, you know, we have to deal with and what we go through and what Jesus even went through and everything. And J.W. sitting in the very back, and I knew he wanted me to share on that. I mean, he didn't specifically say share, but I know he and I have worked together for, you know, almost 40 years hand in hand, and so I know how we function together. But I knew that the people were used to just, you know, hearing it all up here in the spiritual realm. And I said, you know what? People have trouble. You've got troubles. You've got stuff going wrong. I said, J.W. throws fits and goes through stuff and freaks out. Well, you know how I knew that? I didn't make that up. I know the guy. You know, most of those people don't ever see him in a real, you know, he comes and preaches and they go, oh, praise God, you know. And when I said that, you know what J.W. said from the back? Amen. He told me later, he said, yeah, one time I was reading the Bible and God spoke to me and I took that book and I threw it across the room as hard as I could. Well, I knew that story too. In fact, I was the assistant pastor under him, them, and ducked. But we have this concept. Paul said, I've not yet attained, but oh, we have. Or more specifically, they have, and something's wrong with me. That's the more clear dealing. I'm telling you, folks, we're all in this ark together. We're all dealing with beasts, but we're going somewhere. We're heading somewhere, and God's hand is on that cocoon, that ark, and he's going to bring it to the intended destination, and we can trust that. So what I'm going to do is go ahead and close, but I want to ask you to keep your hearts open, because I believe in the night session, I believe the Lord wants to just work and do some things after we get through, and maybe some prayer for people and stuff like that, and maybe you already got prayer this morning, but God's not finished with us. And I would much rather us go out of here saying, I met the Lord, and nobody even knows how much I needed to meet the Lord where I was at, than to go out of here and say, oh, what a great conference, oh, and let's go spread the word that, you know, those seven people really had a great conference down there. I just want Jesus, and I tell you, I want Jesus for you, and I don't care about anything else but that God be able to do for you and to minister to you. And I believe that people have come and they are hurting or they are confused or they're struggling with certain things. And I've told our people, I've had a few people say to me, I need a breakthrough during this conference. Oh, we can't say that. That's what they say. We need to say, I need the cross, or if people need a breakthrough, then Lord, breakthrough for them. I don't care. Meet them where they're at. Meet them where they're at. So let's pray. Father, our hearts are open, and we want to be more open, and we want you to be able to just walk around in us and be comfortable in us as your home. And we're getting that to that place. And so we ask you, Lord, if you want to do something tonight, if there's areas that you just want to talk or open us up or help us and meet us there and take us to a whole new level on that front, then we ask you to have your way, because it's what you intended. You brought each of these people here. You have ordered the time and the season here. Please, Father, may there be no restrictions on our part. May you be glorified through your Son. Holy Spirit, all freedom is yours. In Jesus' name, amen.